It's Psalm 46 and it's titled God, the Refuge of His People. I'm going to read verses 1 to 7. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth should change, and though the mountains slip into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake and its swelling pride. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she will not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations made an uproar, the kingdoms tottered. He raised his voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Amen. Our first song will be All the Way My Saviour Leads Me.
Oh,
our next song is Just As I Am.
Chapter. In the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. The message was true, but the appointed time was long, and he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant food, no meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Now on the 24th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, the Tigris, I lifted my eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with the gold of Uphaz. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in colour, and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone, saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but a great terror fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Therefore I was left alone when I saw this great vision, and no strength remained in me, for my vigour was turned to frailty in me, and I retained no strength. Yet I heard the sound of his words, and while I heard the sound of his words, I was in a deep sleep on my face, with my face to the ground. Suddenly a hand touched me, which made me tremble on my knees and on the palms of my hands. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak to you. Stand upright, for I have now been sent to you. While he was speaking this word to me, I stood trembling. Then he said to me, Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. And behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had been left alone there with the kings of Persia. Now I have come to make you understand what will happen to your people, the Jews, in the latter days, for the vision refers to many days yet to come. When he had spoken such words to me, I turned my face toward the ground and became speechless. And suddenly, one having the likeness of the sons of men touched my lips. Then I opened my mouth and spoke, saying to him who stood before me, My Lord, because of the vision, my sorrows have overwhelmed me, and I have retained no strength. For how can this servant of my Lord talk with you, my Lord? As for me, no strength remains in me, now nor is there any breath left in me. Then again, the one having the likeness of a man touched me and strengthened me. And he said, O man greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be to you. Be strong, yes, be strong. So when he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, Let my Lord speak, for you have strengthened me. Then he said, Do you not know why I have come to you? And now I must return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I have gone forth, indeed the prince of Greece will come. But I will tell you what is noted in the scripture of truth. No one opposes me against these except Michael, your prince. Well, this is an amazing passage of scripture. And what's the main theme of the scripture? It seems to me to be a glorious vision. The vision of the Son of God, the vision of the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. When was the last time we had a vision? Not necessarily seeing it with our eyes, but at such an encounter with God, we knew he was speaking to us. That, to me, is the great thing which comes out of this. Now, this chapter, in fact, chapter 10, 11, and 12 are one piece. You can't take them in isolation. And chapter 10, of course, comes before lots of other things that have happened, but they're not in chronological order. This is a great prophetic theme. Anyone who doesn't believe the scripture and doesn't understand the scripture, when they read and when they seek to understand, they have to fall down before the living God, who is perfect in foretelling the future. Because every single thing, the prophecy in this chapter relates to, well, a little bit the immediate future, but more the medium-term future, and then it delves in the long-term future, which we haven't met yet. May not be long, but we haven't come to it yet. So this prophecy is an amazing thing, but as in all these things, it's an amazing thing personally for Daniel himself. It isn't just the eschatological or the prophetic aspect of the passage, it's what it means to us and how we should behave in light of how Daniel behaved and what kind of man he was spiritually. Now, when you talk about the glorious vision, I can't ever say I've had a vision of heaven. I know people in our family have, Judy's sister's husband, they lived in Sussex. I don't know whether you know, but at one time, Sussex was known as the Bible Belt of England. There's been a tremendous history of the gospel in Sussex. And in his family, the brother said that when just before my father died, he had a vision of the glory of heaven, and God showed it to him. And the other brother said, I knew I was going to die because I, just before it happened, I had the same vision. These things are possible to anybody. But it isn't the fact that these things are glorious. In fact, the vision that Daniel had drove him to his knees. He couldn't cope with it. God is so powerful, so majestic, and so much higher than we are. And we sometimes are so casual with God that we don't understand it. We don't miss it. Or we do miss it, rather. The verse 1 here is a summary. Look what it said. The message was true, but the appointed time was long. That could mean the appointed time is going to be difficult. But the appointed time was long. It's not the immediate future. And he understood the message and had the vision of it. Well, if you just read that verse, it's easy, isn't it? God gave me a message and I understood it. But by gum, when you get down to the detail, he couldn't cope with it. The problem is always the detail. You give a testimony, do you trust in Jesus Christ? Yes. Well, how did he cope with that? What are you doing with this? You see, the problem is always in the detail. I believe in Christ. Well, does your life show it? Are you consistent? Does everybody know it? That's the issue. You see, Daniel, it was fine for Daniel to understand the summary of it. He could write the summary of it easily. But he didn't cope with the detail. Why? Because he got nearer God. How near God do we want to be? Because you better be careful. Because what you find, you might not like. And the testing time's coming. Heard the testimony this morning. You've heard Gary pray this morning. And Bev giving testimony about what's happening. It's not the first time that's happened. It's happened right through history. And far worse times, although what's happening now is very sad indeed. What about the Boxer Rebellion? When all the missionaries sat in their mission stations waiting for the terrorists to come and kill them. This has happened many times in history. It's a terrible thing. But in Proverbs 29, verse 18, it says, where there is no vision, the people perish. If you read the Authorized Version, in a more modern version, which is more understandable in this verse, it says, where there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint. Well, where's the revelation of God? First of all, in our society. It's like looking for a needle in a haystack, isn't it? But where is it in your life? Where is it in mine? Where's the revelation of God? What did he say to you this morning? What have you learnt this week? We've had a testimony from Barbara this morning about that. I'm sure there are others. We don't have to share everything, do we? After all, a believer is supposed to get their own food from the scripture, aren't they? Not live on tidbits from somebody else. That's what we need to do. But where there is no vision, where there is no revelation, the people cast off restraint. And that is exactly where we are today. Exactly. Well, we know in 2 Thessalonians the restrainer that's holding everything down is the Holy Spirit. My goodness, what's it going to be like when we go in the rapture and there's no Holy Spirit to control it? Exactly. It'll be a terrible, terrible time. So, what Daniel is talking about here is of tremendous importance for every single one of us. Tremendous importance. But the whole thing is about the glorious vision, and it's about Jesus. And it's Daniel in this context, and he heard, he understood, and he accepted But it wasn't easy. Is it easy when God tells us what he thinks of us? And how much does he tell us? You think he's told you? The problem is, I thought he had. Then next week, there's something else. And then there's something else. And then there's something else. We have to walk humbly before our God. Because when we do get to know more of him, we find each time how much more holy he is than we thought he was. But the whole of this is summarized in power. It's the power of God. You know, I remember years ago, people critiqued, I was baptized in the Spirit when I was 17, a long time since, but used to talk about it. People used to criticize it and say, well, you talk about all these things, you've got all the experience, but where's the power? Well, it's a good question you could apply to all church today, isn't it? Where is the power? Yeah. Have we got power in our own lives to live humbly and to walk as Jesus said? That is the question. Well, this is a tremendous passage of scripture. And Daniel mourned for 3 long weeks and had a fast. Well, it's a partial fast. He didn't fast wholly. You've got to remember, Daniel was getting on for 90 years old, certainly well over 80, when he was doing this. You know, we've all got a ministry. There's no such thing as retirement, is there? You know, the time to rest is later, isn't it? When we get in his presence. But Daniel was an old man. And why was he bothered anyway? He got all life's comforts. He was an important person in the empire. Well fed, well housed, no immediate problems. He'd come through all the early problems of the lion's den and all that stuff. And he's great. He's got a fantastic life. And it's the kind of situation where any one of us in that kind of thing would think we don't need to bother about anything. We're okay. And everything becomes superficial. Not Daniel. If you are blessed today, financially, economically, in every other way, that's a dangerous place to be. The Apostle Paul says, I have found to be content in all circumstances, whether I have a lot or whether I have nothing. But Daniel was in this place of comfort. But what was he bothered about then? Why was he fasting? He could have had steak and whatever every night. The best wine. Could have had it all. He didn't even put his aftershave on or whatever people spray on themselves these days. He was fasting for 3 weeks. And he was praying to the Lord for 3 weeks. What was he concerned about? Well, it wasn't himself. That's a big factor, isn't it? When I move more from being concerned about myself to someone else. But Daniel was concerned about Israel. He was concerned about the nation of Israel because they'd gone back into the land. But only 50,000 of them had gone back. The rest were too idle. They just stayed where they were, enjoying all the good things of life. They couldn't be bothered making the effort to do what God had told them to do and what was prophesied in the scripture that they should do. And this weighed very, very heavy on Daniel's heart. He was very concerned about the nation of Israel. That's what he was concerned about. And that's why he was fasting. It says in Psalm 122, verse 6, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we've looked at other things looking at Daniel, and we see that God's main focus is not on any other nation other than Israel. Well, in the church age, the focus is on the church, but the church age is falling apart and coming to the end, and the focus is switching back to Israel. So God's focus is on Israel again. So perhaps as well as praying Maranatha, come Lord Jesus, we should pray more for the peace of Jerusalem. And that will bring the Lord back quicker. Maybe. But that was what was weighing on Daniel's heart. He was concerned about Israel. How concerned are we about the church? Yes, we pray for the country, we pray for the politicians, but the politicians only reflect what's going on spiritually. You know, people have said, the first thing that goes down in the church is the church. Church goes down, then the culture and the government goes down. And what's the church doing? That's our problem today. Well, this upset Daniel very, very much. And why? And it wasn't just that. It wasn't just the issue of Israel going back to the land. It was the issue of the people's lives. And I was reminded of this verse at the end of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 7 and 8. It says, "He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death." There are many lists you can find in Scripture that characterize sin. Some of them we can understand with the culture that we've been brought up in. But the cowardly, the unbelieving. Have you ever been frightened to do anything? Would you be called a coward? Be careful. Be careful where you end up. This was why Daniel was where he was. And in verse 5 to 6, we find that, well, the focus here is on the one he's looking at. The focus is on Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Just as our focus needs to be continually on him. Sometimes we don't even know what he's called. I mean, I had a look, what are the names of Jesus? Well, I found about 100. I didn't know there were that many, did you? I found a few. It says, "I am Alpha and Omega. I am the author and the finisher of your faith. I am the blessed and only potentate, the only one. I am the bread of life. I am the creator, the deliverer, the everlasting father, the good shepherd, the head of the church, the Holy One of Israel, the King of Kings, the Lamb of God, the light of the world, the Lord of glory, the Messiah, the morning star, the Prince of life, and the resurrection and the life." My goodness, a study on the names and the power of Jesus Christ ought to lift us out of this world completely. But what's our practice of it? What's our practice of it? Are we getting fellowship? Are we getting properly fed from the Word? Are we living on titbits? These are the issues. So he was concerned about the eschatological aspect of the nation. He didn't know what was going to happen. And he was concerned about the nation, the hearts of the people who constituted the nation. That's what he was concerned about. And of course we know that the cross is the answer to everything. Jesus is the one. Without him we've got nothing. We are absolutely dependent on his precious divine love and what he did at Calvary. All our sin has gone at Calvary. All of it. Buried in the depths of the deepest sea, as far as the east is from the west, the scripture says. Guilt has gone. That is the most amazing thing. God was satisfied with the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross of Calvary. Jesus ascended up to heaven. God accepted it. And anyone who names the name of Jesus is absolutely clear as far as God the Father is concerned. Now, Daniel, I'm sure how much he knew of that fully, I don't know. But you know, the Jewish people say, well, was it Amir Sephardi said, I got saved through watching the Jesus film, isn't it? He said, but everything that was said, I didn't need because I'd read it all in the Old Testament. It's all there. The gospel is there. So, and it's in so many places in the gospel. And you find it in the names of the patriarchs. When you translate the Hebrew names of the patriarchs, it's the gospel message. Yeah. Isn't God amazing? And so many times Jesus disguises himself and he comes as the angel of the Lord. If you look at the Hebrew, he's the Malach Hashem, which means it's a divine presence of Jesus. For example, talking to Abraham, that's who it was. Many occasions. So Jesus Christ is the actual one. And I am sure this was deep in Daniel's heart, that he knew that. He knew what it was. And whatever need we have today, if we're saved, fine. If we've got a testimony, we've been born again, and we know it, fine. Practice it. Keep telling people. If you don't, you'll forget half of it. But if you keep doing it, you'll remember it, and you'll tell it with more power. Is it you need something else? Is it you've got problems in your life you've never dealt with? Is there some kind of deliverance needed? I'm not saying that necessarily in a demonic sense. It could be in many senses. There's all sorts of things we need to live a godly life for Jesus Christ. Because Jesus said, I have overcome the world. But do we know it? It's easy to say it. It's easy to have the summary of it, isn't it? But the detail, that's where the problem is. Getting answers to it. Well, in verses 7 and 8 here, it said others didn't see the vision. And they ran away. They knew something was going on. They ran away, but they didn't see. They just didn't see. And what does that mean? It says, I, Daniel, alone was drained. Drained. And I had no strength. Now, the ones that weren't in the same place of fellowship with God ran away. Daniel himself, who was in the right place, was absolutely drained. You know, isn't this the total opposite of what we read in the charismatic movement so often? People meet with God and they're filled with beans and dancing around the place. I'm not saying there's not a place for that, there is. But to meet with God doesn't produce that. We had someone years ago in the church, actually, I had an experience. Went to somewhere and he said, I got slain in the spirit and I was lying on the floor. So I wrote to him and said, I didn't think that was correct, the way it had happened. And how he explained it. And he said, oh, I don't agree with you. He said, it was so wonderful and so nice. It couldn't have been anything else. Completely forgetting the devil's an angel, Satan's an angel of light. And that Satan can do all this. Just because you feel good is probably the wrong factor. When you get in the presence of the Holy God, you don't feel good. You feel bad. You feel humbled. Yes. That's the issue. But this is how Daniel was. And in fact, in Revelation 6, so let's turn to that. This is the seal judgments. Revelation 6, the seal judgments. And we've got an issue there, verse 12, I think it is. And it says, and I looked, when he opened the sixth seal, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it's shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it's rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave, every free man, hid themselves in the caves and the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. This is the gentle Jesus, meek and mild, but coming in power and glory. And an unbeliever just wants to get away. The ones who may have known him had to run away. Daniel stood his ground. He's the one that had seen the vision. He's the one that had seen it. And he said, I was alone, I was drained, I had no strength. Well, the quality of our worship. If you want to look at the quality of worship, time's going, but look at Psalm 29. Psalm 29. And realize what the quality of worship was. And in verse 9:10, he said, I was in a deep sleep, face down, notice, touched, trembling. And then he was getting up, he was on his knees, shaking like this. Couldn't control himself. When God's in control, you're not in control. Even though the fruit of the Spirit is self-control. That's a conundrum, isn't it? But when God is in control, he's got control of your life. And Daniel couldn't do anything. He was on his hands and knees, trembling, fearful. And that's exactly where he was. No strength left. And in verse 11 and 12, the messenger came. And the messenger had been delayed for 21 days. Why was Daniel praying for 21 days? When was the last time you needed to pray and get an answer from God as to what you were wanting? Now sometimes you can get it just like that. Sometimes you haven't uttered the prayer. God knows your heart and gives you the answer before you've asked it. Other times he doesn't. Other times you've got to struggle with it. And you might struggle with it a few weeks or even longer. If you are struggling. God knows if you are or not. Because he reads our heart. But that when we're in that particular position, why is it that it takes so long? Well, I don't know. I don't have an access into the spiritual realm other than what God reveals. But here, it took 3 weeks because the messenger bringing the message had been restricted. Everything's a spiritual battle. That's what's going on in Afghanistan. It's what's going on all around the world. It's a spiritual battle. And that's what we see here. Daniel was trembling. But in verse 11 and 12, we have this phrase again. We saw this the other week. You are greatly loved. As we explained, that's everybody's love, but it is a special case of filio. Daniel was greatly loved. And you've got to understand. Now, if you've got to understand, stop lying down and resting. Get up and listen. You know, sometimes we have a wrong idea about faith and it becomes mystical. As though God's going to intervene and do everything. Well, if God wants you to know something, get up. You need to be bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, is that the expression? Yeah. You need to be focused. You need your brain working. It's getting more difficult for me at my age, but you need your brain working to understand what God is saying in the Word. Stand up. I've got something to say to you. That's what it is. And the powerful prayer was heard. And he humbled himself. And there are many scriptures which speak of the effects of this. One of the greatest ones is David in Psalm 51. Because he's talking about his own heart and his sin after Bathsheba. And it says in the scripture that he knows that God requires a humble and penitent heart. That's not the right words. I can't bring the right words to mind. But that's what he needs, to get right down to the bottom. Broken and God requires a broken and a contrite heart. A broken heart means you're not in control. Broken, you can't do anything. It's contrite, you wish it hadn't happened. But it is. And David knew it. And that's why David was such a powerful saint. That's why David's coming back as a king of Jerusalem in the millennial reign. That's what it tells us in Ezekiel. He was a man after God's own heart. Just as we see in Daniel, that Daniel was the same. Daniel humbled himself. in verses 13 and 14, it says the messenger was resisted for 21 days. Well, people have said, well, this is Jesus. How on earth could he be resisted 21 days? Well, he couldn't. But we mustn't assume the messenger was actually Jesus. Even though the vision is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the messenger is another spiritual agent. There are many of them, many fallen gods. We're not going into that this morning, but that's what it is. If you want to see Jesus in power, look at the book of Revelation chapter 19. When he comes from heaven in flaming fire, taking vengeance, and the sword comes out of his mouth, that's all he needs to do. Just speak, and it's over. That's when God comes in power. It's when Jesus reveals his full power. Right now, it's shielded to some extent. And he sends a messenger. And there was this resistance for 21 days. And then he's told, well, you'll understand this in the latter days. The latter days. And then he talks about the kingdom of Greece. Well, that was yet to come, and that was absolutely true. It's one of the prophecies that Daniel gives that were absolutely true to the letter. And we've looked at quite a few of these as we've gone through. But absolutely, incredibly true. So, you know, God's purposes cannot be thwarted. Job, if you want to reference Job 42, verse 2. Job says, the purposes of God can never be thwarted. If he's got a purpose in your life, it will be carried out. It requires your submission, your humility, and your dependence upon him. And it requires an acceptance of his word. And it requires that you to do everything that God has said you should do. If you're not reading the scripture, if you're not in fellowship, you won't be an overcomer. Amen. You'll be a struggler. Yes. All the time you'll be struggling. It's just black and white. Nothing's more obvious. But we just treat God like anybody else. Will I go to church today? Well, if I feel like it, if it's convenient. Will we pray this morning? Oh, I can't be bothered. I feel tired. You can go on and on. How important is it? Well, either it is or it isn't. If it is, go do something about it. It's not rocket science, as they say, is it? It's written down for us. Well, there's, because many other times in Scripture, there's a delay. I mean, why do we have to wear the armour of God? Because God isn't giving his full might to a situation. And he's taken us in it, and you have to do something. And you have to put it on. And we don't want a life that's up 1 minute and down the next. If you live on titbits, that's what you will get. You'll read something, somebody will tell you something, or in these days they'll text it about 20,000 times a day in Judy's case. But when you get all these things, you feel great, it answers my need. And then the day after, you're just where you were before. That isn't what we're meant to be. That isn't an overcomer. An overcomer lives a consistent life. Yes, there are issues. We have to deal with it. We can have a bad day, a bad week, but we have to cope with it. And then we come up. That's what the life of an overcomer is. And this is a consistent pattern right throughout Daniel's experience. An overcomer. But in verse 15 to 18, Daniel was speechless. Absolutely speechless. And then touched his lips. It's like Isaiah chapter 6, isn't it? Had a vision of God. And he felt just dirty. He'd been a believer. But he realized he was dirty. That is our state. Dirty. And touched his lips. Then Isaiah opened his mouth. Said, what is it you want, Lord? I'll go wherever you want me to do. I'll say whatever you want me to say. I'll do whatever you want me to do. Even if we didn't say the words, that was implicit when we trusted Jesus Christ for salvation. And if we don't live up to it, there's something wrong. We're not living up to it. And this is the issue. When God gives a word, it's a true word. I was drawn to Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Just a few verses. It says, "Do not be rash with your mouth, and let not your heart utter anything hastily before God, for God is in heaven and you on earth. Therefore, let your words be few. For a dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words." You have to be careful. It's a big danger for preachers, isn't it? Don't prattle on too long. Be humble. That's what it is. Then in verse 19 to 21, he said, "Now you know why I have come. I must return." Then he talks about the Prince of Greece. And he says, Michael, the archangel, is delegated to fight. And he talks about its reference to spiritual warfare. And gives a prayer to overcome. Is the awareness of the resistance that's happening in our lives. We need to be constantly aware of that. But there's another issue here that sometimes we get into trouble. I've made this mistake myself. You know, sometimes we pray against the powers of darkness. Paul never did. When Paul went to Ephesus, he didn't have a prayer meeting and said, "We pray against all the evil spirits here and these this pressure group here and that group." He just preached the gospel. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. If God's going to change anything, it's through the gospel. See, the spiritual victory's already won, isn't it? On the cross of Christ, Jesus defeated the powers of darkness only and disarmed them, it says in Colossians chapter 2. That's done. Preach the gospel. Don't be a coward. Preach it with humility and humbleness, recognizing who we are. And when it comes across in truth like that, it can have an effect. Now, it may not be the effect we want, but it will be an effect. And that's what happened. So, what do we say about all of this? Well, we can say that if you read the New Testament, you find that we're called to be peace lovers and overcomers. We're called to put on the armour of God. We're called to fight the battle. We're called to be strong. Ephesians chapter 6 verse 10 says, "Be strong in the Lord." Now that's an easy thing to say. And we can learn the scripture. But what does it mean? When the temptation comes, when the fear rises up, what do? Come back to Jesus, realize his victory on the cross, realize who he is, what his power is, what he's done for me, and I will stand up and do what he wants, even if I don't feel like it, even if I don't feel able to do it. That's what it means. Be strong. Don't buckle down. Don't give in. Don't give up. That's Daniel went up. Daniel's nearly 90 years old. I wish he was a bit younger, then I have an excuse. But he was an old man. And he didn't go back with the other people that went back because he wasn't fit and able at that age. That's where he was staying, where he was. But his ministry was to pray. His ministry was to know. His ministry, thank the Lord, was to look at you and me also, and to reveal the scriptural truth about the future events in the world, what was going to happen when the kingdom of Persia, the Medes and the Persian, was destroyed, when it was overtaken by Alexander the Great, when that was overtaken by the Romans, and, of course, in other scriptures in Daniel, we get the end time, when the revived, so-called revived, inverted commas, Roman Empire comes to power. and the Prince of Darkness comes. But we will be out before that.
Amen.
In the rapture. So we have to take strength. Jesus always fights for his people. If you look back over your life, if you look back over the history of the church, those who have been here long enough and stood the test of time, you realise how God has protected us from so many things down the years. God is doing that with you because he loves you. God is doing that in aspects of your life. God is protecting. God is keeping. But the boot's now coming on the other foot. Things are moving to Israel. God is protecting Israel. And, well, I think we'll be out before then, but I could be wrong. But in Ezekiel 38 prophesies the war. And the more you look at the world events, you see everything absolutely there for that battle to start against and overwhelm Israel. But God steps in and deals with it. That is a sign. You're back to the old covenant days of the Old Testament when God moved in power for his nation. So he calls us to be strong, to be a witness, to be prayerful, to be humble, but above all else, to seek him and to have our own personal vision, whether it's a vision or whatever it is, our own personal, closer relationship with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. May he bless us in his own name. Amen.
And for our last song is What a Friend We Have in Jesus.